two-dimensional vectors, level 7. In this video, we will go over various examples that make use of the algebraic definition of scalar multiplication and vector addition. Let's jump straight into the first example. Use vectors to determine whether the points P, Q, and R are collinear. Alright, recall that we solved a similar problem by using the segment addition postulate from geometry. This time around, we want to use vectors to show that these three points are collinear. One way to accomplish this is by finding the component form of two distinct vectors, with each vector having at least one common point. This way, points P, Q, and R will lie in the same line if and only if one vector is a scalar multiple of the other vector. In other words, if both vectors are parallel. Alright, let's generate two vectors. One vector will be formed by points P and Q, so we subtract the x-coordinates and y-coordinates to obtain the component form of vector P, Q. Then, we do the same for vector P, R, and subtract the x and y-coordinates to obtain the component form of the vector. Notice that it really doesn't matter in which direction the vectors point. As long as both vectors have a common point, we should be able to determine that one vector is a scalar multiple of the second vector, regardless of the direction we choose. Looking at the vectors, we see by inspection that they are indeed parallel to one another, since vector PQ is 2/3 of vector PR. Hence, both vectors are parallel, and we used a common point to form the vectors, in this case, point P, which means that the points are indeed collinear. Alright, let's try the next example. Find K so that vector A and vector B are parallel. Alright, here we are given two vectors, and we are asked to find the value of K that will make both of these vectors parallel to one another. Notice that K represents the y component of vector B. We need to somehow set up a relation between both of these vectors that would be true if both vectors were indeed parallel to one another. Recall that two vectors are parallel to one another if one vector is a scalar multiple of the other vector. In other words, vector A equals C times vector B. With this relation, we can go ahead and find K. We first break apart this vector relation component-wise. This will yield two distinct equations. The x components yields the equation 3 equals c, and the y components yields the equation negative 2 equals c times k. We know from the first equation that c equals 3, so we go ahead and use this result and substitute this value into the second equation and solve for k. So, in order for these two vectors to be parallel, vector b has to have a y component equal to negative 2/3. Alright, now let's try a couple of examples that make use of vector addition. Find the sum of the given vectors and illustrate geometrically. Alright, in this example, we are given two distinct vectors, vector A with components 3 and negative 1, and vector B with components negative 2 and 4. We are asked to find the sum of these two vectors algebraically, and then we are asked to illustrate the vector operation geometrically. Recall from the previous video that the procedure to add vectors algebraically requires that we take each of the vector's x and y components and add them together to obtain the components of the resulting vector. So let's go ahead and take the x components of vector A and vector B and add them together as follows. And then, we do the same for the y components of vector A and B, as follows. In the end, we obtain the resulting vector in component form with an x component of 1 and a y component of 3. Now let's go ahead and use the triangle law to show that the sum of vector A and vector B actually forms a vector with an x component of 1 and a y component of 3. So we go ahead and place vector A in standard position, as follows. Then we go ahead and align the tail of vector B with the head of vector A, as follows. Lastly, we obtain the resulting vector by drawing a vector from the tail of vector A to the head of vector B. Notice that the resulting vector has an x component equal to 1 and a y component equal to 3. This is the same answer that we obtained by adding the vectors algebraically. Notice that adding vectors written in component form is a lot quicker and more precise. We will be carrying out various computations with vectors in multivariable calculus, and carrying out vector operations algebraically will be more convenient and will save us the trouble of consistently drawing vectors. All right, let's try the next example. Given points O, A, and B as vertices of the parallelogram OAPB, find the coordinates of P. Here, we are provided with the coordinate points of three vertices of a parallelogram. We are asked to find the coordinates of point P. One way we can find the coordinates of point P is by creating two vectors, one vector that starts at the origin and ends at point A. Let's label this vector as vector A. The second vector starts at the origin and ends at point B. Let's label this vector as vector B. Notice that if we were to add these two vectors by using the parallelogram law, we would obtain a resultant vector that starts at the origin and ends at point P. We can then use the components of the resultant vector to find the coordinates of point P, since it represents the terminal point of the resulting vector. All right, we can write vector A in component form as 1, 5, and vector B as 3, 1. Then we go ahead and add these vectors component-wise. Doing that, we obtain the resulting vector equal to 4, 6. Since the resulting vector is in standard position, the components of the vector will also match the coordinates of the terminal side, in this case, point P. This example illustrates how vectors can be used to solve many type of problems in analytical geometry by drawing vectors and using the properties of vectors to your advantage. All right, let's go over the final example. Given vectors A and B, find the following. Okay, here, we're given vectors A and B in component form. We are asked to find the magnitude of vector A, the sum of vector A and vector B, the difference of vector A and vector B, 2 times vector A, and the sum of 3 times vector A and 4 times vector B. Let's first find the magnitude of vector A. To find the magnitude of a vector in component form, we simply take the square of each of the components, add them together, and then take the square root of the result. Carrying out these operations, we obtain 5 as the magnitude of vector A. Now let's find the sum of vector A and vector B. To find the sum of vector A and vector B, we simply add them component-wise. So we add each of the vector's x components together, which results in 2, and we add each of the vector's y components together, which results in 5. The sum of vector A and vector B yields a vector with components equal to 2 and 5. Next, let's find the difference of vector A and vector B. Similar to the previous vector operation, we go ahead and find the difference by subtracting the components of each vector. In this case, we take negative 4 and subtract 6 for the x component. And we take 3 and subtract 2 for the y component, which results in a vector with components equal to negative 10 and 1. You can also think of vector subtraction as a special case of vector addition by making sure you distribute the negative sign to each of the vector's components before adding. Now let's find 2 times vector A. To calculate the scalar multiplication 2 times vector A, we simply take the scalar 2 and distribute it to both the x and y components of vector A, as follows. This results in a final vector with components equal to negative 8 and 6. Finally, let's find the sum of 3 times vector A and 4 times vector B. Similar to multiplication and addition of real numbers, We go ahead and follow the order of operations to find the resulting vector. We first need to carry out a scalar multiplication for vector A and B. So we go ahead and distribute the scalar to each of the vector's components. Then we go ahead and add the resulting vectors, making sure we add them component-wise. In the end, this vector operation yields a vector with components equal to 12 and 17 for the x and y components, respectively. Alright, in our next video, we will start taking a closer look at properties of vector operations. We will also learn how to prove these properties.